This is Singapore. In Sanskrit, it means Lion City, and it is the perfect name for this island city-state that throughout its history has fought for its place in the world. Today is aggressively deploying new technologies to continually improve the lives of its people and to ensure its place as a pioneering city. However, that was not always the case. In 1965, Singapore became an independent nation. Much of the country was poor, there was little clean water, and many families lived in shanties. The first Prime Minister, Lee Kuan Yew, drove economic development with high-rise housing and clean water. He had a legendary insistence on excellence.
This was a mud flat, swamp. Today, this is a modern city. 10 years from now, this will be a metropolis.
Today, Singapore is a vibrant, sometimes flashy nation, one of Asia's so-called tiger economies. It is home to nearly 6 million people on just 270 square miles. It is but a tiny country, but its size doesn't diminish its place in the world. Smart city technology could be the difference in Singapore's future. Steve Leonard, CEO of SG Innovate, is arguably the best person to talk about smart technology in Singapore. His new government agency is devoted to translating R&D innovations into commercial success.
What is it that makes this such an attractive tech place, and what is it that allows them to talk about smart nation as opposed to smart city?
Well, a couple of quick things. Smart city for us is a great adventure that we see a lot of different places pursuing, but it's just that. It's a city. It's a more local adventure. Now, admittedly, we're a city and a nation together, but we're trying to do something ambitious and holistic. So every part of Singapore, the health, the transport, the energy, everything that goes into the nation, we're trying to be involved with under this banner of smart nation. And that means, how do we use information more effectively? How do we tackle some really tough problems around aging population, urban density? So a lot of cities are working on things, but we believe they're working on them more narrowly defined. And we're trying to do something more broad.
What are you doing with the urban density thing? I think you can maybe hit the highlights.
Sure. Urban density is something that affects a lot of different countries and cities around the world. More and more people getting into smaller and smaller spaces. So the implications on transportation, public safety, resource efficiency, such as energy supply, are really big and difficult challenges. So we're thinking, what's the role of autonomous vehicles? What's the role of a shared infrastructure, where you would have more ride sharing, not necessarily in a platform like an Uber or a Lyft, but more that you would have a citizen-led type of platform where everybody's a part of that network or ecosystem.
And then what are you doing with the elderly example?
Well, we've got a lot of healthcare that we're thinking about. Aging population is a challenge or a reality that almost every country in the world is wrestling with right now. We're going to have a tripling of citizens above 65 in the next 15 years. You don't want people to have to go sit in a doctor's office and wait to have a relatively simple scenario such as blood pressure checking for a chronic condition that you need to manage. So if you can do that remotely using technology and still provide care for that person, that would be a great improvement for them and also take strain off the system. So for us, Smart Nation will come to pass. It's just a question of us continuing to push ahead, be comfortable taking some risk, be comfortable experimenting more than we have sometimes in the past, in order to build some amazing things.
To get a better perspective on smart medical technology, I met up with Dr. Stephen Tucker, an expat who's lived in Singapore for a decade.
The non-Asians. It's hot.
Okay, I know. I can't even talk now.
See, but you're dipping. I'm just pouring.
I'm barely pouring.
It's so good.
Well, every time I eat hot food, my head sweats, and so that's why I wear a hat. So my experience reading about Singapore before coming here is that, you know, it's really gone through massive transformations in the last 50 years. And I wonder if a lot of the improvements have been because of technology, certainly water quality and that kind of thing, right? Or
well, there's infrastructure that's been built. And of course, your opening statement's 100% accurate. There's been transformational change in the 10 years I've been here. And the country just celebrated its 50th anniversary last year. So they've really gone from, you know, developing to developed in just one generation. Knowing what you're interested in dovetails perfectly with some of the ideas of the Smart Nation Initiative, where we're putting sensors, they are putting sensors into new homes to monitor the health of elderly shut-ins, elderly widowers and widows. The primary sensor is a MEMS device, a microelectric mechanical sensor. These are what's in a Fitbit. This is what's in every, you know, it's an accelerometer. These accelerometers are pennies. You could sprinkle them across a carpet to see how fast someone moves across the carpet. You could even identify if they're shuffling back and forth, which might be a sign of Parkinson's disease. Everyone has to realize that we are in a pivot. We are pivoting away from a reactive, medical-based system into a proactive, wellness-based system.
I think we should get a second on this stuff.
It's all good. Yeah. Should get some ice ka-chang.
That's what we're doing.
Okay.
To find out how the country's smart tech is being applied at the earliest stages, I'm heading to a local preschool.
Hello. A lot of schools are grappling with how to teach coding at a very young age, which the attitude in Singapore is that you want to have a positive experience, just like you want to have with mathematics, so that the very youngest people will grow older and have an appreciation for it and not a negative approach to it. Oh wait, you can't do that. This is called Vibat, and what it teaches sequencing, and sequencing is important for coding, obviously. So these students are using this little robot to learn how to sequence. And if you go from 0 to 20, it's 5 spaces. So you push the forward button 5 times, and then if you want to turn left, there's a left turn button and a right turn button. The point of all of this is really to teach coding eventually. There's a very strong integration in this school system between practical concrete skills and coding skills, which are very abstract.
I'll see you guys later. Nice meeting you. Hardest part of going to preschool is getting up.
Okay.
Okay, so the kids here are about 8 years old. They're learning Scratch Junior, which is a junior level programming or coding. So essentially, they're learning how to do a coding curriculum from this young age. When they move on to what we use called Scratch, makes it colorful enough, it's easy enough for them to understand what's going on, which in turn would manipulate the characters to move in a certain way. So simple coding knowledge is necessary to make this work. At the end of one, I'll say curriculum course period, we'll actually use a group environment or pair work to give them a simple project. So the last project that we gave them was global warming. So come up with some sort of theme, how to save water, how to not do littering. Yes, it's quite a big, I'll say it's quite a big theme.
Why not go for the really big topics? Okay, okay.
Smart Nation, the objective is basically to use technology to help our citizens to live better.
Bash is the brainchild of Dr. Alex Lin, the head of Infocom Investments in Singapore. It stands for Building Amazing Startups Here, an incubator to foster tech talent.
So we go around the world to recruit startups to come here, and then we provide them with mentorship to help them to build the minimum viable products and ultimately teach them how to present to investors, raise the money, and they begin to build and incubate, become a viable company. The Bash is created as a space for acceleration, and we noticed that the success rate for the startup, the team is very diverse. That means that it's a mixed gender, mixed nationality, mixed background, and they will be a lot more successful. In order for us to do that, number one is that we recruit startups from all over the place, and over at this space, you probably have more than 50 nationality in this space. 50. Okay, out of about 200 over people down here. By putting acceleration ahead of building a product, we increase the success rate to about 40%.
40%?
40%. So that increased tremendously.
This is a Singapore idea, your idea.
Well, this is basically tried and tested for most of the market. Eventually, everybody will realize that.
Singaporeans seem uniquely trusting of their government, and with all the new advancements that are being implemented, I wanted to talk to someone who could give me the local point of view on smart tech. So I'm going to meet up with Sarah Pereira, who has worked with the government of Singapore and has lived here all of her life.
I don't think most people outside of the industry know what Smart Nation means, but I think they have a good idea of the way of where Singapore is going. From a technology perspective, you know, because the government's been pretty good about educating like kids on why this stuff is interesting and important and sort of engaging them, you know. So
have you seen any big significant changes in your attitudes about technology?
You know, I think that the thing about technology and the way it's been deployed is it's been so gradual that you almost don't notice. When I went to university, I was gone for 4 years and I didn't come back very often. And when I came back, I actually got lost going home, you know, to a place where I had lived my entire life. Well, the roads had changed, the landmarks had changed, and I got lost. My mother's house was the same, but, you know, everything around it had changed. The route had changed to go to my mom's place. And I think, you know, that's kind of the essence of what it is like to be Singaporean. Like, you know, your landscape changes all around you all the time.
After a week in Singapore, I've learned that the government is taking a comprehensive approach to smart technology to improve the lives of its citizens. And after talking with government officials, locals, and expats living on this small island, it's clear that Singaporeans expect a lot from the technology within their city. But with a government that is tackling the problems of urban density, water quality, and healthcare with relatively few regulatory hurdles, the people here seem willing to make sacrifices for a better quality of life. And while that might not easily translate to other major cities, Singapore has tech ideas that could and should be replicated around the world.